Good morning. It's nice to be here, especially this morning. I understand many of you are NGO background, so I feel at home because of this similar, same background. As Dr. Busek has already mentioned, this is our fourth day on this series, and I may be repeating myself that I have to mention here. And then I will try to summarize my belief and how I would like to see my country to move forward. And I would like to emphasize that successful transformation will rely on the extent to which the communities are empowered and included, and the support local organizations get. In other words, creating peace requires the involvement of everyone. Everyone needs to build it and experience it. So strengthening civil society and building peace are intertwined. And so let me reiterate, peace is a social state and cannot be developed by mutual men, and cannot be developed without the leadership and will of the people, civil society. So you may like to ask, what level is the health of civil society groups in Myanmar? Is there enough democratic space in the country to allow civil society organizations to form and operate? It is remarkable that in the Chin state, the more human rights violations and military aggressions took place, the stronger the emergence of civil society. Where there were only two prominent national NGOs working in Kachin prior to the resumption of armed conflict in 2011, today there are at this planet. You may be interested to know that even during the two successive military governments of State Law and Order Restoration Council, and State Peace and Development Council, the Metta Development Foundation's community-led development work never encountered any constraints in the operational context in such areas as strengthening civil society. The successive governments and the various ministries, as well as the local authorities, have always been supportive of our efforts in that aspect. Civil society gained strength from the mid-1990s, in spite of the restrictions faced by political parties and constraints placed on airing grievances at the time. The current government, with 25% selected military representatives in parliament, has initiated the formulation of a law on forming organizations. In that process, the government has involved civil societies and NGOs as their main stakeholders in the process. One of the five objectives stated in the draft, I forgot to bring that in the draft, the five objectives has been clearly defined, and it said one of the objectives is, quote, to ensure the strengthening of the civil society organizations. So this is itself is a big step forward. It is also encouraging that in the registration process, comments and feedbacks are provided when an application is incomplete or insufficient and the applicants are no longer simply ignored or left in the dark, as was the case in the past. So it is no wonder that many new CSOs are emerging. Even if unregistered, the CSOs are able to operate with the recognition of the respective global governments. In our women's groups, working with the Ministry of Social Welfare, Relief and Resettlement to legislate a law on anti-violence against women, expected to come into effect this year. Also, the National Strategic Plan for the Advancements of Women 2013-2022 is being introduced by the same ministry. I just read this morning that the Minister Wu Aomin, the head heading the Peace Committee of the government, already proposed at the parliament to add women in the peace process. So while women has yet to have a separate ministry that oversees all foreign aid and development issues that acknowledge and emphasize the role of women, the fact that the current social welfare minister is a woman gives me hope that women issue will be given to prominence. I'm so surprised that the other day I learned that we do not have a woman ministry in this country yet. No. Yeah, and now I heard that you do not have a separate ministry of development. So, well, I think we could catch you up very soon. So, all too often, however, we have also experienced our work being hindered by donor focus on the short-term service delivery of projects, limiting the time and resources available. This has resulted in failure to reach out to the goal of global ownership and in turn reduce the opportunities for a more widespread ELAPOC civil society. Interestingly, the scarcity of aid in our country over the last 20 years has actually created more room for local agencies to determine eventual program. Had we been flooded with aid after the 1990 elections, local NGOs like Metta, Myanmar Ingress, Fangku, Roja, Shalom, for example, would not have had the chance to grow and flourish as they have done. It is ironic that only now that the country has become more open, more challenges are being faced in strengthening civil society. In the open and new Myanmar, loads of funds are being more available under the heading of peace. For those advocating change in Myanmar, I would caution them not to undermine local initiatives, as the reality is that local agendas are vital to bringing about true democracy and lasting peace. Space for civil society to be empowered and local NGOs to become stronger and not undermined will be essential in the current transformational shift in the way and amount of aid being delivered. In short, those of us who have doubts about the capacity and political will of the government and its professed search for peace should consider ways and means of transforming conflicts into lasting peace. While in the past, international governments as well as national political leaders have highlighted freedom and democracy, now many have started to emphasize equality and federalism. These leaders have started to articulate that the peace process must be based on an inclusive nationwide political dialogue. The country's pivotal moment for change is here and now, and the role of NGOs and CBOs is more crucial than ever in the achievement of durable stability and peace. We cannot allow the process to be a solely government-driven, top-down process. Unless we take the hand of the transition, we could fall back to the so-called democratic era of 1948-1962, when the country was open, but armed conflicts were widespread in ethnic states. Citing security measures, only central Myanmar benefited from international aid and investment. So opening up the country in such a way only made the gap between the dominant ethnic group and the other groups wider. How can this do anything but increase the violence? Besides, such a situation could cut short the lifespan of democratic governance and led to an eventual return to square one of a centralized authoritarian government. That horrific road has been traveled before many times in the last decades. Currently, our government is pushing for a nationwide ceasefire that will lead to a peaceful settlement with the armed ethnic groups. As a person who founded a local NGO to complement ceasefires in the 90s, my experience and observations to date led me to strongly believe that ceasefire are of no value unless transformed into lasting peace. In the Tuesday alone, we have facilitated rehabilitation efforts in over 250 war-affected communities. But because of the resumption of armed conflict after 17 years of ceasefire, more than half of these communities have been razed to the ground. Most of these villages are now at camps, spending their third winter along the China-Burma border. So it is not enough for us social workers to merely concentrate on the daily basic needs of the people. We must also strive to enable the civilians themselves to become part of the transformation process. For example, there need to be two tracks in the resettlements of displaced persons and refugees. Firstly, concentration must be placed on the social aspects of rehabilitation and empowerment. This includes health, education, economics, and environment. Secondly, there must be political solutions so that people are properly represented and consulted on all social and political issues that affect their lives. In this transition, the educational opportunities of our young people must also be promoted. They must have opportunities to study and give of the best of this nation. All children, regardless of social and political turmoil, should have access to an education that enables them to play, create, and solve problems. A retired panel's attitudes quoted in Panyin Books, Where China Meets India, said, quote, "We are a small country. Why should we stay divided in 100 little pieces? Many countries have had to forge unity by force." Following this quote, Panyin Wu wrote that the officer believed that assimilation, true roads, railways, trade and single education system, no recognition of ethnic differences would end the civil war. Then whose interpretation is a reality of which we must be conscious at all times. In my eyes, the Tamajaw, the military, must be convinced that a stand that they seem to hold on to almost fiercely should be modified. The army insists that it has political role. It must prevent the state from disintegrating. But it wants to do this by force. If it really wants to be political, it should realize that force will never be successful in creating a stable and productive state. It must compromise and walk with the ethnic armies who are not rebels in the sense of witches and enemies. They are potential brothers with the same goals, a stable and productive state. The opposite of disintegration is integration. The ordinary dictionary definition of which is the process of becoming a full man. So this brings me back to say once again that it is necessary to resolve the underlying political issues in order to make lasting change possible. The present situation is different from 1948-62 in that we now have a greater sense of civil society. I would say, as a rule of thumb, the transformation process will be faster in regions where community mobilizers are strong, where civil society works well with both the political parties and the ethnic groups. Reflecting on the current situation, Dr. Kien Song-min, a well-known political activist, said, quote, "What is called for is not only brains, but heart as well, and vision. All along, Myanmar has been short of all three. So don't look to the leaders for answers, look to yourselves." As Dr. Kien Song-min says, we should be looking to ourselves, not the leaders, to be agents of change in our society, keeping in mind the many achievements we, the ordinary people, have attained without input from our leaders. What we continue to need, as in many countries in this world, are great ambition, determination, and the hope for reconciliation so that future generations can live in long, peaceful.